verses 1 to 11. When you have come into the land that the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance to possess, and you possess it and settle in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground, which you harvest from the land that the Lord your God is giving you. And you shall put it in a basket and go to the place that the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling for his name. You shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, Today I declare to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our ancestors to give us. When the priest takes the basket from your hand and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, you shall make this response before the Lord your God. A wandering Aramean was my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in number, and there he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us by imposing hard labor on us, we cried to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. The Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toll, and our oppression. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with a terrifying display of power, and with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land overflowing with milk and honey. So now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me. You shall set it down before the Lord your God and bow down before the Lord your God. Then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house. The epistle reading is from Romans 10, verses 8b to 13. The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And the gospel reading is from Luke chapter 4, verses 1 to 13. The temptation of Jesus. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread. Jesus answered him, It is written, One does not live by bread alone. Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours. Jesus answered him, It is written, Worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, He will command His angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. Jesus answered him, It is said, Do not put the Lord your God to the test. When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Grace to you and peace from God our Heavenly Father and His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The year was 1964. I was 12 years old. And in my church, the tradition was that when you were 12 years old, it was time to be engaged by that process called confirmation class. What that meant in our tradition was that we would have a weekly meeting with our pastor, in my case, the Reverend Edwin Murray Crawford. Following worship, our worship service went an hour and a half on a good day. And then we would meet with Pastor Crawford, and we would be seated with him, and he would lead us throughout the entire year in the memorization of the Westminster Shorter Catechism. Any of you familiar with the Westminster Shorter Catechism? It has 107 questions and the appropriate theological responses. And every week we would meet with Pastor Crawford and memorize the question and the answer, two a week. And then it would be explained to us so that we would understand the doctrine of the Presbyterian Church. But we had to memorize each and every blessed question and answer. And so from week to week, we would be called upon to demonstrate our facility with the questions and the answers. This went on for an entire year. And then at the end of that year, we were brought in before the session, lined up, and we would be asked at random the questions that Edwin Murray Crawford decided to torture us with. And we would have to respond with the memorization of the answers to the session. Now you might think that was pretty harsh stuff, but I'm not done yet. Then on the given Sunday of confirmation, you would be brought in before the entire congregation and lined up, and Reverend Edwin Murray Crawford would thumb through the Shorter Catechism and ask you whatever question he wished. And you, in front of the entire church, would have to give the response. Now, all in all, I did pretty well, even though my mind has always been civilized. But I did pretty well with memorizing the questions and the answers. There was maybe five or six that I simply could not get firmly in my mind. But the worst one of them all was the question, what is effectual calling? By the way, this stuff was written in 1646 and 1647. Just, you know, we always were timely in the old United Presbyterian Church. Effectual calling is the work of God's Spirit, whereby convincing us of our sin and misery, enlightening our minds in the knowledge of Christ, and renewing our wills, he doth persuade and enable us to embrace Jesus Christ, freely offered to us in the gospel. Right. Out of all 107 questions that could be asked on that Sunday, you're an old UP too, I know. You remember this stuff. Can you imagine which question was sent to me as I stood in front of the congregation? Effectual call. The beads of sweat began to break out of my forehead. I knew that I was doomed. I couldn't remember my own name, let alone what effectual calling was. But I remembered that my mother was a soloist, a soprano. And she said, if you ever got loused up, just keep on going and act like you know what you're doing, and it'll be fine. So when Edwin Murray Crawford said, Edmund, what is effectual calling? I looked at Pastor Crawford and I said, effectual calling is calling by the Holy Spirit. And since it's the Holy Spirit and therefore of God, it is effective and effectual. It cannot be resisted, but it is asserted with liberty and justice for all. And Edwin Murray Crawford looked at me, looked at the book, shook his head and said, you're going to be a preacher because you sure can shoot the bull. just had read to us, it reminds me of my confirmation process. You have to remember that Jesus was Jewish, very Jewish indeed. And after having been baptized, he's filled with the Holy Spirit. And so in that tradition, just like our confirmation tradition, what would be the first thing that would happen after you've been baptized? After you have identified with your people in those dirty waters of the Jordan River, what would be the first thing that would happen when you are filled with the Holy Spirit within the Jewish tradition? Well, the Holy Spirit would lead you into the wilderness. Actually, in the Greek, it can mean drove him out into the wilderness. He was so full of the Holy Spirit that he had to go out into the wilderness and immediately have his mettle tested by none other than the devil. Satan. Hand-to-hand spiritual combat. That's what it would mean in that rich tradition. To be filled with the Holy Spirit was to be filled on purpose and to be ready for battle. So he goes out within that tradition for 40 days. And at the end of the 40 days, the Satan comes to him to test his mettle. Will he be galvanized? Will the Spirit take? Will there be such a complete integration that he will even square off with the devil himself and be successful in this spiritual warfare? Satan comes to him, this starving man, this hungry man, and says, "You're hungry. Why don't you command that rock over there to become bread?" And Jesus responds, knowing the ploy of the devil, he responds, "Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." In that acute, terrifying time of starvation, Satan comes and suggests to Jesus that his condition is one of scarcity, that he is about to die of starvation, abandoned, that there is no bread around, and the only recourse is to impose his power onto the situation inappropriately and not trust God for provision. But Jesus does not take the bait, because Jesus knows that more than the issue of bread is the fact that he is the bread of life. And in his person, there is never scarcity, but always the abundance of God's grace. Satan comes to him next and says, "Worship me and you will have all the power. All the nations will bow down before you. They're entrusted to me. I will give them over to you. You will have power." But Jesus responds, "You only worship the one true God." And he rejects the misappropriation of power. And he rejects the emptiness of some twisted sort of fame that Satan would provide, because he knows that already in his person he is Lord of lords and King of kings. He is the Lord over all. Satan comes again and says, "Go up to the pinnacle of the temple, cast yourself down." And he quotes scripture that God would give him charge. God would give charge of his angels and take care of him. "Go ahead, do that." Jesus says, "No, you don't put God to the test. You don't test God. I don't need to throw myself down off of the temple to show that I am somehow validated because angels will swoop down and rescue me." Because Jesus understood that he is the sign in himself. He is the sign of God's grace and mercy. He is the one who rescues not one man from the temple, from the pinnacle, resurrection that will come in the days ahead. Satan is, if nothing else, predictable. As we begin our Lenten pilgrimage, we remember that this testing is kind of like Jesus' confirmation class. We remember that Satan is trying to do an identity theft of our Messiah and Lord. And we remember that Jesus prevails. He prevails by remembering that he is the bread of life and that he is the Lord of all and that he is God's sign of God's amazing grace and favor for humankind and God's love. We too, in our wildernesses, will be tested by that hiss of Satan's voice saying, there's not enough. There's just not enough. Hoard it all and just take care of you. Get it while you can. Take hold of all you can. There's not enough. But in Christ, there's more than enough. Satan will hiss at us, go for the power, go for the fame, go for the idolization of the masses. But we remember Jesus, who's Lord of all, and we instead follow him and are pleased by his grace to be a servant and an ambassador of Christ. Satan will say, test God. Jump down off the pinnacle of the temple. Test God. See if he really loves you. He does love you, doesn't he? I mean, after all, maybe you better check it out. Maybe you better see. Maybe you better make sure, because, you know, maybe he's a little fickle, God. But you respond with Jesus, that Jesus is the sign of validation. And you put your trust in him. And you know that you are secure and validated because of him. You are God's child. Yet Satan is always predictable, coming at us with greed and proclaiming scarcity, coming at us with power cravings and desire for narcissistic fame, and coming at us challenging us to test God and to insist on further validation beyond even Jesus Christ. But filled with the Holy Spirit, we in our season of testing, by God's grace and mercy, we too can and shall prevail. But we are not alone. Follow him who is more than conqueror, and his name is Jesus.